mean, I've seen PJ Harvey play live where she's been so fucking attitude and it's crazy, and she's great.
Yeah, yeah. So, I know.
Whatever.
I know.
But whatever, that's fine. But you want to do it, I'm more than happy to.
All right.
All right.
And then the bathroom for the guys, anyone who stays up there, it's down the hallway.
Okay.
So you gotta come downstairs and just go to the bathroom. Okay.
They played at the monastery, which is this beautiful old, like old, older than most buildings, like any buildings we have in this country. Like super old, beautiful outdoor venue. And they came on stage and I watched them, their set, and they were just incredible. And the energy was great, and just, you know, Connie, it was hard not to watch Connie, but then watch Martin, and Nacho was such a great drummer that, you know, they just really had this thing. And Martin was playing and then singing and then climbing up on the speaker stands. It was just a whole full rock show. It was really great. And they pretty much blew my mind.
Estamos en Hoboken, en el estudio Water Music, de unas distancias increíbles, una altura donde resuena toda una reverberancia muy especial. Nos pusieron a disposición todo lo que podíamos imaginar y el equipo de trabajo además es brutal.
Well, good. Then you could actually move the guitars where they're going to be recorded and play for 2 more hours. That'll be good. Right. And even you at the bass, you can just start jamming.
My drums, what is my drums?
They're on their way. They're here. Our friend Jay should be here any minute. Well, he's a drum tech.
Right.
And he's got snares, and I told him about the rack. I told him what we're doing, and he was thinking vintage, and he was going to research.
Nice.
And
Danielo
es como si fuera un tío loco de la familia, ¿no? Enseguida lo sentís como un amigo, como alguien muy cercano. Ya era amigo y ya era cercano, pero cada vez lo sentimos más. Hay como una conexión telepática, ¿no? El tipo te entiende lo que buscas del sonido y va directamente a eso, ¿no? Es súper rápido. Y sobre todo es alguien en quien confiar, ¿no? Que esté del otro lado de la pecera, que es lo más difícil, ¿no? Alguien en quien confiar, ¿no? Que está alquimizando tu sonido.
Let's go now record a minute with this snare, 30 seconds with this snare and Starman.
Okay.
Then we'll do another snare,
okay.
Starman. Then we'll do another snare, and then we'll compare all the snares.
Okay, good.
Tenemos la misma idea, ¿no? El grupo y John, que era, bueno, los primeros días, grabar el grupo tocando las canciones, todos juntos, y luego el resto de los días ir trabajando las voces y algunos arreglos. Bueno, y arreglos para cada canción en particular.
You know, we started the first day, the first day of every record is literally setting everything up and getting, you know, sounds on everything and getting the proper drum sounds and guitar sounds. What was really good about doing the record this time was that we were going to do the actual record in sequence anyway, because the record already exists. It's a record. So we were going to start with 5 years. And, you know, it's a good situation in a way, because we have a record to go back to listen to. So whenever we're interested in hearing a sound or a performance or a vocal or whatever, we can go back and listen to the David Bowie record and listen to the version of 5 years that is on the record. And I found that we went back and forth a bunch and just listened to how they approached the record sound-wise. And I won't say we stuck closely to that, but we used it as our, at least I used it as a kind of sonic or audio guide to what direction to go to. I certainly made some decisions on how I thought the drums should sound from listening to the old record. And, you know, clearly it's 40 years later, so technology is totally different. There's no way this record is going to sound anything like that record. And to be quite honest, the people who made that record were pretty much top to bottom incredible, you know, genius. So, you know, our record will be a good documentation of the band's perception of that record now, basically.
Pushing through the market square. So many mothers sighing.
But it just basically starts with just a drum beat, which that drum beat continues throughout the whole song and just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. So I think what is really compelling to me for that song is really just the mood and the vocal. I mean, it's just beautiful.
Pues sabiendo que Bowie estaba super influenciado por la Velvet Underground, sobre todo en sus inicios, ¿no? Así como nosotros también, ¿no? Tenemos esa influencia. Vimos que en la canción Pale Blue Eye de la Velvet, sobre todo en el arpegio, ¿no? de guitarra que hace Lou Reed, puede haber un comienzo, ¿no? Un comienzo desde donde empezar a desarrollar.
I think the most difficult is this, because this is, seems like you can just do this and this you sing and then it would take
no, but
to do
this
that.
Melody.
Empecé tocando con timbal, luego se sumó la pandereta, que era ese factor que no lo tenía porque no lo podía tocar en ese momento. Y luego cuando escuché todo el conjunto de los timbales, la pandereta, la guitarra que dice Martín, pues ahí me empezó a cuadrar y lo empecé a ver realmente que quedaban bien esos timbales, vamos. Y ese sonido velvet, crudo, simple.
I think that's my favorite part so far. Because emotionally, I think it's like when he sings the whole thing, it's very emotional, you know. We could do it the other way if you feel like, but listen, I think it's good.
Years, como en el resto de las canciones del disco, las líneas de bajo son muy distintas a mi forma de tocar en cápsula, que es un estilo más oscuro, hasta más new wave en algunos casos. Así que para meterme en la forma de tocar de Trevor Wolder, el bajista del disco, de Ziggy, tuve que, claro, que entender su forma de llenar y de vaciar las canciones, y durante una temporada fui de alguna forma su él fue mi amigo imaginario.
Five Years is the kind of overall story of the record, for me at least. And what I love about it is the mood, first of all. I mean, the mood is very somber in a way, but it's a love song. And the arrangement is really just the chords. It's very delicate, but then it builds into a crescendo of just, you know, David Bowie screaming and, you know, at the end, and all kinds of just chaotic stuff going on at the end.
Sinatra.
Claro.
Estaba haciendo un documental del estudio. Que está que te cagas. Porque lo ves a Roger Waters cuando mete el delay de, en el bajo de tum 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 tum. Y pero empieza, y es todo eso, ¿no? Todos los ruidos, toda la atmósfera esa, y empiezan ellos, cuatro, sentados en lo que sería esto, ¿no? Digamos, en la cocina del estudio, los cuatro así, sentados, tac, va pasando la cámara, los cuatro de ellos, con su desayuno, tal, no sé qué, el sonido de eso, ¿no? Como, está súper, está muy bien. Tiene una cara de haberse levantado y fumarse un porro con él.
Mañana llega.
California, abajo
una chusta así, de porro, y empezaron a revisar a todos. Y uno tenía porro y al talego
2 meses. Dos chicos, la furgo pudo seguir y le pusieron un multón, pero dos chicos tuvieron que quedarse en el talego 2 meses. Porro se perdió la gira, una chusta.
Pero además en California no se debatió y no se votó.
Pero
para enfermos,
bueno,
en Los Ángeles no habéis dicho que era.
No, les dieron la patente.
En Los Ángeles, Austin. Pero si te pillan en Los Ángeles,
no sé cómo. Una multa.
You don't have to do like, you know what I mean? You don't need as much of that stuff.
Okay.
You know, think of David Bowie and John Lennon, how they push, like stone, like that.
Stone.
That, like that.
More nosy.
Que era la canción más distinta al sonido de Cápsula.
Un poco de folk, vamos, estar tocando unos timbales en el medio de la pampa.
And we listened to the vocal, David Bowie's vocal, before he sang it, just to hear how he was kind of delivering it. And I think that kind of got us both in the right spirit of how it should be sung. And I think at that point he sang maybe 2 or 3 more takes, and he had the version that we're using, which is their version.
Una de las pruebas que hicimos fue ponerle mucha distorsión al bajo y el resultado es curioso porque quedó una visión del amor futurista.
Yo en el primer día se apareció, me hizo un regalito y apareció con una Jazzmaster, además las que tenía yo, con una de Jay Maskis, ¿no?, de Dinosaur Jr. y otra de Lee Ranaldo de Sonic Youth. Que para Soul Love, el púrpura de la Jazzmaster de Jay Maskis le iba a dar ese punto púrpura del espacio.
Soul Love is interesting because on the original record it's a little more of a pop song, and ours rocks a little more. And I think basically what we did was, I think we just kind of worked on the song to make it just kind of hit harder and still have the same kind of feel of the original song. But basically it's the whole balance of trying to keep true to the original song but also get, you know, what Capsula does best, which is, you know, play a little faster and a little heavier.
Soul Love es básicamente una canción de amor, ¿no? Y nosotros lo que queríamos expresar con nuestro sonido era una especie de rabia o furia o la agresividad de ese amor, ¿no? Como diciéndole al mundo, el amor es lo más importante.
Me duele los dedos de pena de cortar la rec.
Hola, Vicky. Tengo una milanesa para ti, mira. Oh. Yo soy el jefe de cocina de la gira.
Uy.
Mamá, ¿viste cómo aprendí?
Played a little faster because Capsula really is, you know, a three-piece rock band, so, you know, we have to keep true to that.
El punto de partida, más allá, más que la canción del disco, fue la versión de David Bowie en Santa Mónica en el año 72.
Yes, if I don't have the click, it's like, what the fuck?
Los aires,
imagínate.
Don't fake it, baby. Let the world sing on me. Just my head.
Este es nuestro homenaje a las guitarras y especialmente a la figura de Mick Ronson. Bueno, y todos los guitarristas, ¿no? De principios de los 70. Forma de diferenciarlos es de diferenciarlos con nuestro sonido es a través de un sonido más filoso y cortante, ¿no? Lo que buscamos.
algo como más de los noventas, algo más noise, más sónico.
I will say on the Bowie record, there's a lot of arrangement, instrumentation, like horns and strings and reeds and stuff like that. And obviously we're doing three-piece guitar rock, so our versions are way different in that feel. But I think we spent a lot of time trying to make the solo section or the instrumental section feel as uplifting as the original feels.
Put the click in 30 seconds or 40 or 1 minute.
No, less.
This is the same of nothing for me.
No, I think you have to think that you have to play slow.
This was with no click, right?
On.
Yes.
Yeah. Just try playing it without no click, just a little slower. And you try to sing.
It's not dependent on
me. Okay, he will sing. Okay.
It all depends on you.
No,
I always say it depends on me.
Come here. You're the boss of the tempo. They have to follow you.
No. There is the doors of the temple.
You gotta slow down.
Yes. Yes.
Wait, come here, don't go anywhere.
No,
we gotta figure this out. That's a very good take. It just needs to be a little slower. That's all. Really. That's really the bottom line. Just try to get in your head a little more. You sing for him.
All right.
You keep it slow. You don't rush. Right. You don't rush. You listen to his vocal. Mwah. It'll be beautiful.
I don't rush.
Look at you. Come on, Nacho. Such a drummer. It's always the drummer.
Okay. Man waiting in the sky.
Toca la risa.
Sí.
keep right? No.
No, go to hi-hat.
The same thing?
Same thing, just better.
But like I said, maybe more rock in those sections. A little faster, maybe.
Faster.
And then come back for the rest. Not that thing. It's a little more rocking, but it really feels great, and Martin did a great vocal on it. It's just such a beautiful song and so lush. And you know, once again, I think I'll say this a few more times, our version is not as delicate. It's actually really great because it's kind of in a really great place in his range. Like the upper Bowie range is also the upper Martin range, which is good. So yeah, that one came out really great.
Cuando salió el disco original era el single y es la canción que todo el mundo conoce, ¿no? El punto era encontrar un sonido y unos arreglos que la llevaran a nuestro terreno la canción, ¿no? Que fuera cápsula pero que a la vez no perdiera ese punto de belleza, ¿no? que tiene la canción original.
Lo que quisimos hacer fue darle otra vuelta a la canción y unirla con, por ejemplo, con el grupo de Kings, que nos gusta mucho. Y bueno, y en el sonido del bajo, sí, seguíamos usando pedales de distorsión que le dan como un carácter muy, muy sólido, pero al ir sobre un tempo más lento también le daba como una tonalidad espacial.
I mean, I think as a standalone song, forget about a cover song, it really is a very cool version of Starman.
Nuestra base está en el sonido de las guitarras, entonces el punto era encontrarle a todos esos arreglos orquestales o de cuerdas, poder hacerlos o cubrir ese espacio con ruidos o con sonidos extraños de las guitarras. We'll be right back.
Okay, that's getting really good. Don't worry about the pronunciations of those lines. We'll do punches and fix them.
All right. Can I go to hear from there?
Yes, you can. It ain't easy to tune that guitar. It ain't easy to tune that guitar.
Es la única del disco que no es de escrita por David Bowie, nos permitía un juego que nos gusta mucho hacer también en Cápsula, que es de pasar de ambientes vacíos a estribillos muy, muy cargados.
The end of Easy is good, so you're doing pretty good. It's just the ain't is a little...
Ain't.
It's ain't.
Ain't.
Yeah, ain't.
It ain't.
There you go.
It ain't easy.
Estaba ahí con una orquesta sinfónica y con muchos timbales y masas y más timbales grandes y muy grandes.
Las raíces de la canción son gospel, son blues. Y nuestra aportación tenía que ver algo más con lo velvetiano, con los timbales, con algo más oscuro, con las guitarras, con las capas de guitarras armando texturas. Letra de la voz, ¿no? que tiene algo que ver con algo blues, con algo que tiene que ver con algo universal, ¿no? de la esencia humana, y por otro lado las explosiones, ¿no? En los estribillos de reverberación, de fuzz y de energía.
It's interesting, we tried that one vocally a bunch of different ways. We tried it delicate, we tried it acting, we tried it a couple of other ways, but we ended up kind of hitting a situation with Connie where she was starting to sing a couple lines out really loud and really powerful. And we realized that that was probably the best way to go for the entire song. So it's really just her belting that sucker out, and it really came out great.
Bass and drums are together, and guitar and keyboards are together, but I'd like everybody to be together.
Okay.
And I don't think we need to do the whole last chorus. Let's just go at the after the last chorus. The that shit.
Okay.
She kicked ass on that one in the sense of she really worked hard to like make that happen, because that one was probably the most confusing of all the like deliveries, because we definitely spent a lot of time out there listening to the vocal, and we were like, well, should we try it this way or this way? And she finally got it. I mean, she got it, and she got it great. Once she got it, she locked in, and it was really awesome.
Uste proiektu bat egiten duzunean bi alde dauzela. Alde batetik zeure sugustora geratzie eta proiektua benetan barrutik eitzie, eta gero beste bat da bere irtenbide komertziala edo zerengo dan horregaz. Nik uste toinez tala momentu pentsetako zerengo dan edo izango dan arrakasta edo izango dan frakaso bat edo geuretzako izango dan edo zeusek pertsonala. Oin da momentu disfrutetako estudizoa, abesti zekalik eta ondoen eitzie, eta gero ja emaitxe ikusten dugunean, ba, pentseko dugu edo pentseko dabe eurek, zelan bideratu, egingo dugune bira bat, edo zelan kaleratuko dan, garrantzi asko emon edo ez, baina, bueno, Pentsetan dut eurek topera ibiltzen diez, ikusten dut oso bierginek dizela. Hemen begun guztiz egauz topera, egin dugu zen sesinioak oso luziek izen diez, azten gara amarr, goizeko amarretan. Eta gabeko amaikatar dizetan amaitzu dugu, azken nengo biegunek. Eta ikusten dut zuen duen proiektu dugu, ba, pentsete, aleko itxurian DJ izetiena.
Tengo unos que me quedan un poco grandes allá.
Te dejo para ponérmelo, ¿vale? Yo le escribí a Larry y a Sherpa. Ahí van.
¿Quieres estos?
Hay otros de estos allí, ¿eh?
Ajá.
Sí, mejor no.
Mira, ahí está el mundo.
I'm Chris Kane. I play bass in a band called We Are Scientists, and we met the Capsula folks in Colombia last month when we both played a festival in Bogota.
Estamos acostumbrados a escuchar el disco, el original en vinilo. Lady Stardust es, bueno, cuando das vuelta el disco y empieza el lado B. De alguna manera es como el comienzo de la caída, ¿no? Del fall, del rise and fall de Lady Stardust. Nuestra idea es como si el sonido viniera ya desde otro lugar, ¿no? Más lejano. Y bueno, y para eso usamos lo que mejor sabemos manejar, que es el noise un poco y los ambientes.
Fue muy divertida para mí, porque vino Chris de We Are Scientists a tocar el bajo y fue muy divertido escuchar su manera de tocar el bajo y tratar de que no me cambie lo que ya me había aprendido y de cómo la veía la canción, pero al final muy bien.
Lady Stardust fue la segunda que canté en el estudio, pero después cuando la escuchamos dentro de todo el disco quedaba un poco raro dentro del concepto general, ¿no? Y de cómo se iban sucediendo una canción detrás de la otra. Así que lo que hicimos fue volver a grabar los coros y la idea que teníamos era, bueno, pasar los coros por un Leslie que le daba un efecto a la voz, como estar debajo del agua o dentro de alguna máquina espacial también, no sé, buscando un poco el sonido del Blue Jay Way, del Magical Mystery Tour o la canción de Lantern de sus majestades satánicas.
Lo que intentamos es que diera la sensación que la canción viene desde un lugar extraño y a la vez extraterrestre.
Me recuerda mucho a las imágenes de Ken Russell, que en algún punto con Bowie ciertas imágenes se tocan, en algunos universos se unen.
This is gonna be great. I think we should do one or two more, but it feels great.
They seem quite suited to the task, I would say. Yeah, they definitely have a sort of more authentically early 70s quality to them in general than any other band I've met, I must say. It's strange. It makes me wonder what's going on in Bilbao these days, in a good way.
Golazo Llorente 1-1. Partidazo intenso, intenso.
Hay que darlo, hay que darlo.
Hay que tener tiempo, ¿no?
David Bowie's cover, The Man Who Sold the World, in Spain was banned. I don't know if internationally, but right. He was dressed as a woman,
right.
And it was banned.
Yeah.
Rock and roll to this guy, it's like the guy doesn't eat at all, you know. He only takes cocaine and milk.
Right. It's a barbecue suicide. Get right in there, buddy. That's great. Chicken is wonderful. Okay, anyway, you get it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's our version is so different.
Yeah, I know.
That it's difficult to get the.
Really?
I'm trying a kind of Richard Hell, I think, or something like that.
Right. Okay. All right, try it. Little Richard Hell. Love comes in spurt.
A partir de Star, yo creo que se va a respirar un poco el sonido de una banda en directo.
Star is pretty much just, you know, just a rocker. It's full on. The band had the arrangement together when they got here, and it was really just great.
Al principio queríamos. Encontrábamos algo en Revolution de los Beatles, ¿no? como un blues arrastrado, ¿no? Probamos algunas cosas también, como de Cramps.
Me tuve que olvidar de la base original, pero mantener los cortes y algunos arreglos.
En un momento dado apareció como por arte de magia el mago, ¿no? El Mark Bolan y T-Rex.
Yeah, that one was really fun to do, and Martin was all over that. I mean, he was just very comfortable with that one. I for some reason, I don't know this for a fact, but I feel like maybe that one is maybe one of his favorite on the record, because he seemed to really just be all over it. Yeah, that one was pretty easy. I mean, they kind of just locked in really great, you know, and it's a really kind of simple song in a way. By the way, none of these songs are actually simple. They're all really complicated, but that was one of the simplest and straight up.
Lo voy a probar con slide y sin slide, a ver qué les parece. Doblada, doble. Y después lo que voy a hacer es...
Elijamos una, vos hacé las que las tenga grabadas.
Vale, las escuchamos.
Un poco la mezcla de todo eso fue como una especie de, bueno, nuestra imaginación, ¿no? Como si estuvieran juntos Mark Bolan y Lux Interior, ¿no? Con, mezclados con los Beatles, algo raro y fascinante.
Responder llamada.
Ahí está. Hi Ivan, it's Martin. Yeah, very well. We are at the studio. Thank you very much. Nice to. All right. Oh, perfect.
All right, it's fine. I can hear it. Yeah, we might have to do this in sections, but yeah, I did this in the demo. I'm kind of playing it fast, like the demo is. The demo's a little faster, but yeah. I mean. Look at that.
Ivan Julian came in and played on, which was really fun because I'd never met him before, and I know the band has played with him a bunch. And it was just a blast. I mean, that one is once again another straight up rocker. And it's a really great song, and they kind of were all over it. That one was one of the more... just more immediate ones to hit.
Yeah, maybe. I see it. Like...
When Ivan came in and played on it, it was him and Martin just jammed together on guitars, and it was really just fun. That was the first thing. I hit the talk back and said, hey, that was really fun. Let's do another take. And you could tell they were just having fun jamming together.
Awesome. That one, that outro solo was really good, actually. Before that, but once you hit the solo, you were playing that really cool melody thing going into the solo. And it worked against Martin's guitar.
Cool.
I mean, you guys want to come in and hear the one that I think is the good body of you know.
I was pretty impressed with their whole thing. And him and Martin... definitely jammed together really great.
Nice.
Yeah.
There's some nice rhythm stuff going on there. I like
it. Yeah.
I think we did it.
Excellent.
We actually did two albums because I mixed their last record, Rising Mountains, and then they convinced me to make a solo record, and they were the band for the solo record, and it did really well here in the States, and people in America loved it, you know, and I always talk about them and how great they are, yeah. Downstairs, it's like, I mean, it Bowie's album is a great body of work. I mean, and it's his signature on it. But from what I heard, they've kind of taken it to a more rock and roll level. I mean, if that's possible, it's like it sounds raw and you know, it sounds current. I think it's a good idea what they've done. Yeah, I mean, and the songs sound beautiful. Plus, you know, you have Connie singing, which is amazing and great. Yeah. Yeah.
influencias de Cápsula está claramente, ¿no? Todo lo que pasó en New York en el año 77, sobre todo en el CBGB con grupos como Richard Hell and the Voidoids o Television. Y bueno, y especialmente la canción Hang On To Yourself de Bowie, creemos que sí abrió muchas puertas, ¿no?, a este sonido que luego más tarde se llamó punk, ¿no? Y bueno, por un lado queríamos encontrar las raíces de ese sonido y por otro sí que le encontrábamos un punto que podía ser algo como 50s o surf o rockabilly, ¿no? Y bueno, entonces, qué mejor que para esto que juntar de un lado con la guitarra a Ivan Julian de los Voidoids y del otro a Matt Duarte Rey, ¿no?, de Speedball Baby y de Heavy Trash.
Sing it well. I mean, that's the thing as well. It's like it's a different slant on it than them Bowie singing it. So that alone, it just changes it into something kind of new and different. Anybody, I remember the past 2 years I've gone down to South by Southwest, and Rolling Stone magazine like loves them, writes about them. Any time I've been in a room where they play, people love them because they really perform, they put out, they love what they do, what it shows, and they, and you know, Americans outside of New York City maybe, I mean, but they love performance, they love live music. I mean, New Yorkers do too, but you know, there's too much going on or something. But when you play out in America and you really put on a good show, people love it. So I think you're going to really like it.
Es muy bonita.
Entramos al sótano del señor. 500 saxos.
No.
Colgados de la pared.
No fastidias, recién fueron a buscar un saxo para que Gaiska hiciera los saxos.
¿Sí?
Trajeron, sí, y Gaby.
El señor era un loco, un científico loco.
No, no puedo creer.
Yeah, but I think that Connie want to do less notes.
Yeah, I will do the bass line again because I also did it. Well, not all, but some the parts I have to arrange.
Alright.
Okay.
You know what you have to do.
Yeah, that's the part I didn't
do. Guyska, how is your guitar?
I think it's okay, but I don't get the sound of the harmonics. Tan, tan, tan.
Can you add later? Things.
Yes.
Say again. Well, why they should kill the man and had to break up the band. Oh.
Yeah, just don't rush. Break up the band is ba 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 ba, but legato, not staccato. But break up the band. It's very much in time.
Okay.
Va a entrar Bowie por esa puerta.
¿Cuál?
Y me va a caer a trompar. Me va a empezar a pagar patadas en el culo.
Escuché el original un poco para los tú estaba abusando de eso.
No, pero igual...
Yo, de hecho, lo que Connie me decía, no le digas nada. Yo te iba a decir que le bajara un poco la claqueta, inclusive.
Pero si no voy con claqueta.
No, para que yo con la intro ya empezara más lento.
Pero yo los vi que ellos ya estaban adentro escuchando el disco del original. Entonces,
claro, si me quedé cuatro... Me quedé
haciendo
cuatro.
La versión más lenta, es como era...
Pero lo estaba escuchando por los feels, eso, por los tú-tá, porque lo estaba abusando de eso.
That one gives me chills still to this day. So when we were recording it, I was just kind of all like feeling a little like, I don't know, getting like chicken skin. It's just such a great song, and we got a really great version of it.
Yo soy uno de esos chicos, ¿no? Que empecé a tocar la guitarra acústica y de las primeras cosas que aprendí fue el riff de Ziggy Stardust. Y es un riff perfecto, no necesita nada, y el cambiarle cualquier nota por nuestra parte hubiera sido una especie de herejía. Así que la diferencia igual está más en encontrar nuestro sonido, ¿no? Más que en las notas.
Tocarla lo más parecida, respetando siempre esos redobles que le dan la personalidad a la canción, vamos.
Combinación de rock and roll y una tensión súper fuerte en el final, ¿no? Sobre todo a nivel de interpretación.
There is the tension of the choruses. Our song moves around a little bit. I think theirs is a little more contained, but I think ours is really great, and I think it really fits. It fits in the place it does between the other songs in a really great place.
Which one, Leper or Messiah?
Messiah.
Oh, okay. Do you feel it? How about that? There's that. From Messiah, check it out. You like that better? No?
No. In the last one, I think. Better?
Okay.
That was a bit chair.
Bisher?
Chair? Chair. The thing. Like,
believe in love after love.
Yeah.
I apologize for scaring your daughter.
That's
good. That's good, right?
Perfect.
And I will say, Martin really nailed the vocal on that one pretty straight up, pretty quickly.
That's better pitch. Now, can you do that whole line a little more relaxed, a little more laid back?
This part?
Yeah, the Ziggy play, more of a space, more breath. Yeah, nice and relaxed. Here we go. A single player guitar. Great. Okay, I think we got plenty of those. Let's do another couple of full takes.
Con los Beatles, ¿no? Como ellos te das cuenta todo el tiempo, bueno, lo que hablábamos, ¿no? Que se están imitando, que Harrison está intentando imitar a Lennon y Lennon a Harry, todos están intentando llevar la voz a un sitio neutro donde todas se parezcan, pero lo bonito es que no es la misma.
A mí, de hecho, me costó muchísimo aprender, saber qué canciones de quién, incluso confundía hasta a McCartney y a Lennon.
Sí,
Y me acuerdo que en el coche, cuando íbamos escuchando a los Beatles, mi padre era el que sabía, y mi padre nos preguntaba a mi hermano, y a ver, ¿quién canta esta? Y mi hermano y yo, pues, peleábamos, ¡este es esta! Este es Lennon, y no, este es McCartney, y mi padre nos decía quién era. Y al principio costaba, ¿eh?
¡Hey, man!
Hey man, you know, I mean that song is just fun. Nacho got that one like in probably like one or two takes or three takes, and then just, you know, we put some fuzz guitars on to give it like the Capsule of vibe.
Es un ritmo muy 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 básico, pero hay que mantenerlo y. Y esos cortes de tum, 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 también hay que como darle su respiro.
Es el momento donde los Spiders, donde la banda está en su momento más compacto, ¿no? Está disfrutando de la energía de tocar juntos como banda en el escenario. Y esa energía, y por otro lado están viviendo los excesos del rock and roll.
Nos encanta hacerla en directo y yo creo que la energía y el encanto y la fascinación del grupo por tocarla se transmitió en el estudio. Es una gran, gran canción.
It's one of my favorites on the record, and it's really, you know, it's got really, the original has the great Bowie vocal, a great character to it. It's you know, and every song on the record is super special. That one is just a really great chorus, and I just love the spirit of that guy.
Es un tema de rock and roll, pero con mucha personalidad y sobre todo con mucha carga sexual, ¿no? Con una letra hermética, pero que también deja mucho, mucho que ver, ¿no? Va dejando también piezas que ver, y donde se transmite y se huele mucho sexo.
Dale, guacho, dale, que son... Dale, loco, que son las
1
ya. ¿Qué estás haciendo?
Vieja, estoy de las 6. Estoy dejándolo que me exporte todas.
Anda a trabajar, loco.
Y lo estoy dejando solo porque si no, siento que le molesto. Si estoy al lado...
Eso se trata muy bien ahí, lo mata.
No, le dije, cuando lo estaba editando le dije, mira, igual es mejor que yo me esté para que tengas una idea más objetiva. Porque si él me está viendo... Está pensando, no está pensando en el personaje que está escuchando, me está viendo a mí, un flacucho, con cara de bobo.
Recién levantado.
Recién levantado. Y asocia esa voz con ese pibe. Mejor que. No, nada. Mejor que la.
Lo voy a molestar un poco.
Mejor que escuche la voz y piense que no, es un super cantante.
Oye, entre Dios. ¡Hola, papi!
No.
¡Hi, daddy! Ay, son, no tengo ahí.
Playlist that and try one more. Hey, let's play. We're gonna try one more, but we're gonna save that because that's very close. But I still think we can get it closer.
Okay.
So, but definitely save that.
You know what? There's a key that doesn't work on the saxophone.
Wonderful.
Let me take a look.
Yeah, this should come off or something like that, but it doesn't.
Attack.
It's
strange. Flaming lips.
What, flaming lips?
Yeah.
Okay, let's do it again.
I hope you're checking your email, right? That's what you did?
No.
That would be fucking awesome. If you just like, playing me like, okay, I'll see you when I get home.
Thank you. I think it's got that really great stark beginning, which we did with piano and electric guitar, which is pretty great.
Yo creo que Bowie hace un guiño a Machado y el cigarrillo que se consume entre los dedos, como justamente eso, ¿no? como alegoría del paso del tiempo.
Lo que a mí particularmente me emociona mucho de la versión original del disco es la capacidad de Bowie de ponerse en la piel de Jacques Brel y de interpretar como un nuevo personaje, pero tomando claramente influencias de su parte, ¿no?
Martin really delivered that one really well. I mean, and like from pronunciation to even just character, I think he really kind of got the spirit of the song. And it really builds to this crescendo at the end with, you know, the background's going wonderful. And on the original, obviously Bowie is singing his heart out, and he goes from like just this creaky voiced singer to at the end, he's just screaming and shouting and, you know, like kind of pleading to the audience, or pleading to somebody.
Nosotros para este caso, bueno, en el original está hecho con una orquestación brutal de cuerdas y brases y cantidad de elementos orquestales que, bueno, nosotros traído a nuestro terreno preferimos hacerlos con guitarras, ruidos.
Our version does have like a bunch of big things that happen at the end. It's really very cool. We put some fake strings in, but we also have big guitars and the lead. So it really does a similar thing, obviously in a way different way, because the original has strings and just like, you know, like more arrangemental type stuff. But that's one of those songs that, you know, it took like maybe 5 or 6 takes to get it. And once we got it, everything else we put on top really felt really well. I mean, I think we worked very hard in a short amount of time, but, you know, once again, they were very prepared when they came here. They've played the record live a bunch, so I don't think I miss anything. I mean, what I do miss is being able to spend some time mixing it, so it sounds like a record as opposed to just rough mixes. But I think at the end of the day, when everything is sorted out and put together, I think it's going to be pretty awesome. It's a classic record, but it's a different take, and it's a genuine take. You know, it's what they're going to play live when they do the record live. I mean, they're really, you know, it's a record they love that they kind of made their own. My role is to make them their best record to date, because you're supposed to get better every record you make. You know, it's like, you know, as an artist, if you're not making a better record every time, there's really something wrong.
somewhere between Brooklyn and Spanish is English.